Lie down. Lie down. Lie down. Hey, lie down.
Haircut looks good, man.
Oh, thanks.
Stylish.
Good morning, everybody.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Just hit 9:30, so might wait just half a second to see if anybody else joins us, but we will get going pretty quick. And I'm going to start, no offense, just by muting everybody. And we do have a few more trickling in. Well, we are at 26, so a nice turnout for a rainy Friday. Don't know what everybody else is doing with weather like today, but let's get going and talk about prospecting. So just open floor, question for everybody. Who here has enough business? Nobody. So we're all in the right place because we're going to talk about prospecting, going out and getting business today. That is arguably essentially what a realtor's job is. If you read there was a study put out by the National Association of Realtors, which is sort of like the CREA of the States, as most of you probably know. But I would suggest that the numbers would hold up proportionately here in Canada, that realtors spent 64% of their time looking for business. The other 36 was everything else. Open houses, showing homes, listing presentations, everything else was a little over one third of your time, while almost two thirds of your time is looking for business. So it's an important process, obviously, and it's hard work. When I hear the term prospecting or prospector, it makes me think of many of the type of people that opened up this part of the world looking for resources, gold and silver. They'd head off into the woods with shovels and pickaxes and no promise, no guarantee of finding anything. They'd have to work very, very hard, hoping that their efforts would be successful. So it's hard work, and I think it requires a lot of mental fortitude as well. You have to be prepared to accept failure. You have to be prepared to adapt and try new methods. There's a lot of different methods for prospecting. We're going to talk about as many as we can today. And we've got four guests from within the office here. Michelle, Mike, Jay, and Colleen are all going to talk about different areas. And then I'm going to talk about a few, and then we're going to throw the floor open and see if we can talk about a few more. I couldn't even estimate how many different ways there are of prospecting for business, and there's really no right or wrong way to do it. I think the common theme in it is to find a method that works for you, preferably something you kind of enjoy, because then you'll be more likely to do it. If you don't like door knocking or cold calling, you're probably going to find it very difficult to motivate yourself to do it. So don't do those things. Be a networker. Be someone that does social media. Generate online leads. We'll talk about lots of different alternatives, but boiling it down to one, two, or three that really work for you and that you can enjoy while you're doing it, I think is key and pivotal to success in prospecting. Just before we start to talk to Michelle a little bit about referral business, let me throw the floor open. I just ask you to either type into the chat box or shout out what types of ways are you prospecting. Come on, it can't be a soliloquy here all day. So let's hear, what are you guys doing for business? Online lead generation from Mike Dirks. Okay, there's a lot of people doing that. Anybody else? Past client referrals. Well, that's really important and probably your best and easiest source of business. Definitely talk about that. Follow-ups with database, social media. And do we have any traditional people here that are door knocking or cold calling on the phone? Door knocking, Shadi is doing some door knocking. We'll talk to you about that a little bit later, Shadi. Well, let's get on and then we're gonna talk first about referrals. Referrals, I think, is almost the great overlooked one in the whole thing, especially when you belong to a company like this. We've got 18,000 agents across the country. I see the referrals cross my desk because I got assigned for them. And just in the past year, Toronto, Montreal, Saskatoon, all parts of BC, usually referrals tend to come in actually fairly close to town, but they do come from all over the place. That same NAR study I was talking about earlier said that 40% of real estate business comes from other realtors. And we tend to think of other realtors as our competition, but that's not always so. And especially now with the rule changes where we can't double end, it's become even more of a practice within town to refer people out sometimes if you need to do that for council compliance reasons. So great relationships with other realtors is a great way to gain referral business. And that is what I'm going to have Michelle Collins talk to us about today. So Michelle, thank you for being here. Tell us, unmute yourself, please, and tell us about your referral business.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me?
We can hear you great.
Perfect. Okay, great. So this is my 32nd year in real estate. I started with some of the traditional prospecting, open houses. I did a little door knocking. I did a little cold calling. I did all sorts of things in the very beginning. I worked for Century 21 for 2 years, my first 2 years in the business. And I watched this girl come into what Century 21 used to at that point call sales rallies, where we'd all show up in our gold jackets. And this one woman from the Okanagan would come with a big box of apples and hand out apples with her card on to everyone. And she became very well known as the Apple Lady. So in 1990, when I left there and joined Royal LePage, I decided to become known in the company and to try to create that that type of referral business. So that's what I did. And started out locally because we didn't have national events at that point. And went to every, I actually was asked by the head office, human resources manager at the time, had a head office in Burnaby, and he met me fairly early on and decided that I should start the Royal LePage Lower Mainland Social Club, which I did. So I put on all sorts of events, Christmas parties, summer barbecues, that sort of thing, and got really well known within BC. So that was my start. Going forward, Royal LePage did have fairly early on, actually Head Start, which was is a conference that was initially set by realtors, local BC realtors. So of course I was on the Head Start committees, did all of that, went to basically have been to so many conferences that I can't even begin to tell you. Let me tell you how many I've been to. I have been to more than 60 networking events in my career. So Head Start, and then in 1997, Royal LePage finally got on the bandwagon and realized that a company of this size, 18,000 realtors, as Lawrence said, should have a national networking event. And so they started the very first conference in 1997 in Ottawa. So I've been to every single one since then.
And probably the question everybody's wondering is, how many referrals have you generated for yourself, Michelle?
So I would say at this point, my business is 95 to 99% from my repeat and referral business. But most of that repeat started out as a referral at some point. So repeat and referral from my clients and my colleagues across the country. So again, fairly early on when Royal LePage started the national conferences, I decided to do what I did in BC and become known now nationally. So I started putting on events at the national conferences. I am very well known as Party Girl. That's my nickname in the company. I put on all sorts of limo parties, contests, spy games, and my goal always in those was to not only meet people, but to help agents meet each other. And that's, you know, every single conference I go to now, there's at least a couple people who come up and say, you know what, we're best friends now, and we met because of your game in wherever. So
let me ask you this, Michelle. It's one thing to get the referral, put on the events, build the relationships. Then you find out for all your work. 2 years later, you get the referral from an agent in Oshawa or something like that. Tell us about servicing the referral and how you continue to deal with the agents. Do you update them? How do you keep everybody happy with the referral? Mm-hmm.
So one of my messages always is, if you need anything in Vancouver, call me. I will never take a referral if that is not my area of expertise. So people look at, it's like Toronto. Toronto is many faceted. People think Vancouver, if someone's coming to Vancouver, it can mean anything from the island to Hope. So when an agent calls me and says, I have a referral, that this is what they're looking for, often they don't really know location. So I say, great. I make the contact with the client. And if I establish that it's not my area of expertise, I will let them know that. Not that I don't want their business, but I'm not the best person for it. But I know the best person because I have built that network. So I will, so that's my commitment always to any agent who sends me a referral. So I'll pass that to an agent I know has the expertise, and that referral then just gets paid back to the initial agent.
Right.
And then as far as follow-up, because I spent so much time and money building this network, it is my bread and butter. So I value it immensely. So yes, I do. A lot of these people I already have a relationship with, but a lot of them I don't. They get my name from someone else that knows me. And so I commit to making sure that they stay in the loop. I always follow up once I've made contact and, you know, keep them in the loop as we go forward through the listing or through the buying and selling process.
And do you touch base with like an annual phone call or newsletters or how do you keep that going once you've met these people at events and so forth? Mm-hmm. How do you stay in touch?
Yep. So I have a database of my referral network. So these are people who, you know, I have met, anybody I do business with, anyone who sends me a referral, I add to that. And yes, I reach out to people individually on a regular basis, but I do, you know, I do, it used to be more mail. Now it's more of an email newsletter. Just stay in touch. I stay in touch with them. The other thing I do is beyond, because I've built this network, and it's not just me. I mean, the people who attend conferences on a regular basis, the phrase that is often used is the Royal LePage family. And there's no question about it that there is very much of a family feel to it. Phil Soper is the head of our company, and he is right there with us at every party and every event. I know that I can be anywhere in Canada or be going anywhere in Canada and just throw out to the conference Facebook page, hey, does anybody know a good hotel? Does anybody need, you know, I have a friend who needs this. And I always will get that response back from somebody there who's willing to help. Not necessarily a business referral, just help in any way.
Just a reminder, we've got a question in the chat box from Mike Dirks, but anybody at any time, feel free to put a question in there. We'll try to get to it. Michelle, Mike's asking, do you have certain conferences or events you think are most important to attend? What's your priority?
There's an annual event, an annual conference, whether it's Head Start on one year or the National on the other. I would say they're super important. The National Conference is about 1,200 agents. So if you go into that for the first time, it can be a bit overwhelming. I highly recommend the Head Start conferences because they're smaller. It's limited because it's a BC venue, 300 to 400 people. It's much more intimate. You get to know people on a different level. I would say that would be the first place to start. Although anybody can go to a national conference, and whether you're a brand new agent or been around for a while, it's easy. It's easy. It's a very welcoming, warm group, and there's so many events put on that you can't help but meet people and have fun.
Now, let me ask you about this, because another master of the referral program in this company is Alan Stewart up in the Sunshine Coast. I don't think he's on this call today. But Alan, in his own estimation, says probably 30 to 40% of his business is referral business.
Yeah.
Your number is closer to 95%, including with past clients. Where do your referrals tend to come from generally? I appreciate they come from all over Canada, but do they predominantly tend, do the majority come from within BC, or do you get them from other places that are worth focusing on?
Yeah, they come from all over Canada, and it varies. This year I've had several from the island, the Okanagan. For a while I wasn't really getting a lot of BC. So really, yeah, everywhere, all over the country. I'm going to say predominantly Ontario, BC, Alberta. Obviously, it's a huge sticker shock for anyone moving to Vancouver. So that's a process that I have to deal with on a regular basis. I used to do a ton of, not a ton, I shouldn't say that. I used to do quite a bit of corporate relocation business as well. That doesn't happen a whole lot these days, but I have done a lot of that kind of business as well. Just going back to Alan Stewart and his referral business. So as you guys all are fairly new to RolaPage, and this is one of the things that I think is important for people to understand what RolaPage offers. So when Alan was our manager, I think, I took Alan under my wing at his very first conference and introduced him to my girls who love him. And, that was the beginning of, that was his very first conference with RolaPage. And I've really watched now on all of the Facebook forums that his name pops up all across the country if someone says, hey, do you know anyone on the Sunshine Coast?
Great question from Daniela. I think a lot of people are going to be wondering about this one. If you get a referral from someone and the buyer or seller works with you again 5 years later, do you pay that original referring agent another referral?
I do not. I have never expected that from the referrals that I send out. If I send a referral to an agent and they do a great job, that client is a repeat client because they've done that great job and they should continue that relationship. So that's how I've always done that. And I know varying people have varying ideas on that. I think, we have to disclose when we pay a referral. And I think that if I was working with someone who now I have a 16-year relationship with, and I suddenly do business with them again, because whatever I sold them into, I'm selling them out. And then I tell them I'm sending a referral to this person. I think they would question that. They would say, why? What have they done to, you know, the relationship is with you and you're doing the work.
Incidentally, I agree with you on that. I think it's kind of one and done. When you get an introduction, you know, it's fair to pay for that. But after that, I think the introduction has been made. And
I will say that many, many times I have been sent a referral for a transaction, and that person has ended up transacting numerous transactions. I will pay a referral on all of the transactions that come from that initial referral.
Now, interesting, Mike Giesbrecht adds here that he says he knows Richard Robbins recommends this. I think, Mike, what you mean is recommends that you continue to pay the referral. I guess that's to incentivize thus further referrals being the logic. Yeah, Mike agrees. I suppose we could leave that open for discussion, but I've probably been fairly traditional, as have you, Michelle, myself, and that I've only ever felt a duty to honor the first one myself. You've got some pictures here you wanted to share with everybody. So if I can move on to that, I'm just going to share my screen here. And perhaps, Michelle, you can guide me through which one of these you'd like me to bring up first, or does it matter?
Just go random. It's fine. I can't remember what they are, actually.
So here we go. First up, Ontario and Friends 2020. This must have been immediately pre-pandemic.
Yeah, that's the last time I went on an airplane. The picture's not up, Lawrence.
Ouch. Is it not? Okay. Let me try again.
So I'll just talk about that while you're trying to get that up. There you go.
Perfect.
So it's a very interesting thing. So it's not just the conferences that Rolla Page puts on. Through that, agents have become very resourceful and have taken things and made all sorts of events. So this, and the other thing is that obviously we have our Rolla Page awards every beginning of the year, February, March, whenever that is. I have been to many, many award ceremonies all across the country, mainly in Ontario. And this was the Ontario Awards in March, the first week of March. And this agent, Georgina Woods, 3 years ago, I think, decided that to put on an event the day of the awards. And Georgina's right in the very front there, in the gray suit, front and center. And so she started what she calls Ontario and Friends, and she's put on a little mini conference with great panel speakers the day of the awards, and that's what this is. And I've been to that now 3 times in conjunction with going to the awards.
Fantastic. Let's, is this the same group of people? I think it is.
Yeah, double one, yeah.
Double one, okay, moving on.
So this, so when I talk about putting on some of the events, the other thing too that features very prominently in all of the, I'm just going to bring this up here, in all of the conferences, I'm looking for my numbers here. Is the Rolla Page Shelter Foundation. And so one of the things that I've done is I've put together auction items at conferences. So at one conference, someone will bid on that. And at a following conference, I put on a party for whoever was the successful bidder. So this is one where a group of ladies came together with me, and at a conference in Harrison, we auctioned ourselves and a limo party off to the highest bidder. So that's Brent Roberts in the middle. He bought us. And so we have this group of ladies has a nickname of the Red Shoe Rock Stars. And so the Rock Stars picked Brent up in a limo at the airport. with much fanfare and much embarrassment to his to him. And we took him on a limo party in Las Vegas the year we had the conference in Las Vegas. So that's what that picture is. This is just one of our fun little stops.
Well, I can certainly see why he would keep you in mind for his referrals. Here, another group of happy people.
Yeah, so this is the last national, which was Halifax 2 years ago. And one of the events put on by one of the local agents was a trip to Peggy's Cove, which a whole bunch of us went to. And then this was a lobster supper at a very quaint little place somewhere on the way back. I don't even know where we were. And the agent who put this on, he had sold this property to his clients. And so this was a group of us at the lobster dinner.
Okay. And
this was also in Halifax. So this was an event put on by Rolla Page, and can't even remember exactly, but it was one of the dinner events, and they had us broken into all sorts of different venues, and we were piped along the streets, and we had to meet up with our host and find out where we were going for dinner. So that's just me and some of those people I don't even know, because you meet people along the way and you become friends.
The bicycle thief.
Yeah. This was again Halifax, and this was the very first day we arrived in Halifax before the conference had started. And this was just, we went down to the waterfront and found a bunch of friends and had a great lunch.
Okay, and last but not least, this sounds like Peggy's Cove.
Yeah, so this was Peggy's Cove. So this was just this was, you know, again, there was a number of buses that went out. So this was a whole group of us just at Peggy's Cove. So we went out, hung out, and then again, that lobster dinner was on the way back.
Well, fantastic. So if you were to sum it all up, Michelle,
yep.
Is it safe to say that it's just about developing relationships and maintaining those relationships to continue to breed referrals?
Absolutely. You want to be top of mind with your clients, obviously. You want to, and I consider these people all part of my clientele. So I try to stay top of mind with them. So if anyone says, do you know anyone in Vancouver? Immediately somebody says my name. That's my goal.
Hey, Michelle, sorry to jump in. Do you want to jump in too and just say, like, when the conference was here, how many of our agents like worked it and got known that way too? Because that was actually a really fun event that we did.
Yeah. Good point, Sari. So, so when the conference was in Vancouver, when was that, Sari? 2012, I think.
It just showed up in my memories. It was like, I think 2012, and at the Hotel Vancouver.
Yeah. So it was at the Hotel Vancouver in Hyatt. And so it was actually Rolla Page's 100th birthday. So Rolla Page had a lot of events. But because we were the host city, and often now the host city agents do come together and put on events. So because we were the host city, I actually arranged through Vancouver Trolley Company, who I know he's now sold it, but I knew the owner of Vancouver Trolley Company. And so I set up trolley parties. And so we had a whole series of trolleys that kind of circled through at different times to the Vancouver Hotel, picked up people, and everyone had registered ahead. And what we did is I had different agents from the Vancouver office host a party and basically said, here's your time slot, here's your trolley, you're hosting the party, do whatever you want with it. And then, as I say, different delegates from all over the country signed up for different people's trolley parties. mine was quite interesting. I wore a long beaded gown and gave all of my guests feather boas. toured them all around. We had a specific route and toured them around, and stopped in, one of the stops was in Stanley Park, at which point I'd arranged for my, at that time, teenage daughter and her girlfriend to be there with free hug signs as the people got out for their little stop in Stanley Park, because it was an event that happened organically in a conference I was at in Montreal, and it was just so amazing. So I created that for the people on my trolley.
So Michelle, we got started with you because I know you've got another commitment to move on to this morning, but just before we end things off, are there any questions for Michelle on referral networks? We've got a couple of pretty good ones. I thank you, Michael and Daniela, for your input. Mike had a good question for you as well. Last call for questions for Michelle. You can unmute yourself or put them in the chat box.
So I'd like to just finish off by saying, you know, people have said to me over the years, oh my God, Michelle, you've got this wrapped up 30 years. How am I ever going to break into that? But you know what? I know the people I know. There's 12,000 people that go to a national conference. I don't know them all. I don't, not even close. And every single year, there's new agents coming to that conference for the first time. So as a brand new agent, if you go, you're gonna naturally gravitate to those people and get to know those people. And guess what? They don't know anybody else either. So there's tons of opportunity.
Well, I would agree, it's nuts for all the squirrels out there. You know, I would keep in mind really whatever method of prospecting you use, you've got lots of competition. There's other door knockers, there's other cold callers, there's other people building referral networks. So I think that's a great point to not be scared off. You know, there is plenty of business for everybody, as you say.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, Michelle, thank you for sharing some of your secrets on building a referral network. And yeah, thank you. That's from Daniela as well in the chat box. And
thank you all for listening.
We'll let everybody get on with building their own. Okay. Thanks, Michelle.
You're welcome.
Next, we're going to talk to Mike Dirks is going to talk to us a bit about website lead generation. So electronic leads have become more and more popular. Of course, we're probably all used to getting some leads through realtor.ca, through REW, sometimes with listings, and some of you are on the Smart Leads program here. Mike, you've sort of developed your own. I will mute myself because we're getting some feedback and let you tell us a bit about it.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah, hello everyone. Thanks for having me on, Lawrence. I'm happy to share a little bit about my experience with online lead generation. So I'll first of all just start off by saying I by no means claim to be an expert per se at this, but I have been doing this now for about 4 years with some pretty good success. So I just made a few notes here and I thought I'd just go through some of these as talking points. So I guess the first question really people have is why online leads? I mean, obviously the internet has really changed things, I think, for real estate. And I think the stat is now about 90% of people searching for homes start their search online. It's probably higher than that. So there's just a huge amount of prospects. They're all online, that they're all starting to search there. So the question is, can we capture some of those leads and can we create relationships with them and create conversations with them? I also think that there's a bit of an issue now. I mean, if you're doing something in your business that's working, if you're door knocking, if you're sending out some flyers, cold calling, whatever it might be, if it's working, keep doing it, of course. But I think that especially with COVID, there are certain techniques and strategies that are, I think, becoming less and less effective. Door knocking, for example, open houses. A lot of people used to really rely on open houses, and I mean, they were just non-existent for a long time. And of course, I think a lot of people now are pretty reticent to maybe even go to them. So things are changing and evolving. So I think that's another reason why online leads is a potential good source of prospects. So who should work online leads? I think there's kind of two different categories of agents that might want to consider working online leads. One would be if you're a fairly new agent and you're looking to build your business and grow your database. I think it's a good way to start. I think that all agents really, at the end of the day, they want to eventually just have a business built on repeat business and referrals. That's the end goal. But if you're not there yet and you want to build your database, it's a good start. Also for agents who maybe have been around a while, but they're looking to diversify their marketing efforts, or maybe their business has slowed down a little bit, then by all means, it's also a good option for them. I would say that there are really two approaches to online lead generation. The first one would be managing it all yourself. So everything from creating the ads, you know, the Google pay-per-click ads, monitoring the metrics, all the elements of the ad creation you're doing yourself, whether that be on Google, Facebook, Listcast, Instagram, whatever it might be, as well as collecting the leads and what CRM are you choosing to use to collect the leads, to stay in contact with the leads, to follow up with the leads. So the one option is to try to take it all on yourself. When I first started, I did a bit of ad creation myself, but it can definitely be overwhelming. Maybe I'll just ask people who are participating in this call, is anyone running their own ads right now for lead generation? Hands up. No, some people are. Okay. So, I mean, it can be a little confusing. So that's the one option. The other option is to work with a team or a network that already has those systems set up in place already for you, or finding a platform that will do that for you as well. So a little bit about my story. I got involved with online leads when I joined a team about 4 years ago. And started working on a specific online lead platform, and it was great. It was my first exposure to that, and that's actually where I met Andrew Doe, which some of you have probably met now at Royal LePage. But unfortunately, we felt like the splits with those leads were not very fair. So we eventually branched out and we started our own website. So we do have our own website. It's called searchhomesforsaleinvancouver.com. And we utilize a platform called Sync, and that stands for Commissions Inc. They're one of the, I'd say, industry leading platforms for online lead generation in North America. They are a preferred partner with Google because they do so much ad spend with Google. So that's currently the platform we're utilizing with our website. And I'm happy to show you guys what that looks like. If Lawrence, I'm able to share my screen.
Do I Let me just work on it? Okay.
Sorry? Oh. I don't think I can share that.
You're a co-host. It should work for you now.
Okay. All right. Just give me here, guys. All right. All right. Can you guys see my screen? Yeah.
Yeah, we see it, Mike.
Okay, great. So this is what the back end of our platform looks like. Obviously, if you're on the front end, you're going to be seeing, you know, what the consumer sees. But when the leads come in, this is what it looks like on the back end. So this platform is extremely powerful. It will track absolutely everything, and it gives you a lot of information about the lead. So for example, if I'm just looking at this first lead here, Barbara, before I actually open up her profile, right off the bat, I can see that Barbara, that her phone number is here, her email is here. We've already labeled her as a hot prospect. The pipeline status for her, we've already changed to contacted because one of the agents in our network has already contacted Barbara. They registered a long time ago. They're looking in West Vancouver. Their time frame is 8 to 12 months, and so on. So you can see there's a lot of information here. When we open up Barbara, the other great thing about this platform is it, like I said, it tracks everything. So all of the phone calls we make to this lead are tracked here. All the emails that are sent are tracked. Whatever properties they're viewing, we can see as well. Of course, we have our own systems and our own training that we use ourselves, and we give to the agents that are in our network working our leads. Part of that is just is the reminders as well that, that are very important to utilize with the online leads. It's important to remember with online leads that the typical online lead will take approximately 4 to 12 months to actually complete on a deal. So for people who are thinking that, I guess I can stop sharing. So for people who are thinking that online lead generation is just like a magic bullet, it's not. It takes time. To be successful, really, the blueprint is actually pretty simple. If you are willing to carve out 1 hour a day that you can make calls, and if you can do a minimum of 20 calls a day, then you're going to be successful. If you're setting the follow-ups and you're making those calls, you can probably expect a closing rate of anywhere between 1 to 3 to 4%. So it's a numbers game. You're calling a lot of people, you're setting up a lot of reminders. But you know, if you want to add that extra element to your marketing strategy, you could do a lot of extra deals in a year from online lead gen. So any questions?
Let me interject a question here. I asked Michelle, and of course her answer with the referral business is that it, pretty much all of her business is referrals or past clients. What percentage of business is this for you, Mike, the online?
Yeah, that's a good question. I would say probably right now it's around 40 to 50% of leads coming in online. I got licensed just over 5 years ago now, so I'm just getting into that phase of my career where I'm actually starting to see more repeat business and referrals, which is great. And in, like I said, in the long run, that's really what you want. You don't want to have to be calling online leads for the next 20 years, but it's a great way to build your database and to add to whatever it is you do.
So let's talk about something I know is very important with online leads. Let's talk about how quickly you get back to those leads.
Yeah. Yeah. So best practices would be within 5 minutes. I mean, when our system alerts as soon as they sign up, we have their email and their phone number, and ideally you're contacting them as soon as you can. There are certain scripts that we use that are very simple to learn, and we train agents in our network working our leads how to use the scripts. And yeah, you want to reach out right away. If you can't get a hold of them, then you want to try calling them back. Best days and times are usually like on a Tuesday or Thursday, 8 a.m. or 4 p.m., 8 to 9 or 4 to 5 are usually the best times to call. And you want to try to call a lead a minimum 6 times to get a hold of them. Oftentimes, you won't get a hold of them the first time. So you got to set those reminders. Yeah.
Just a note on best time, it's a bit of a sidebar, but I always used to like to say the best time for prospecting is now. I always found it was too easy an excuse for a lot of salespeople to sort of say, oh, I'm going to do it Friday, 2 to 5. And then something else came up. Well, this Friday I have to do PDP, but I'll get back on it next Friday. And it just becomes part of a bunch of excuses why you're not prospecting. And so my motto has always been the best time for prospecting is now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I'm not always calling during those hours. I usually call when it works with my schedule, but I know that they say best practices, you're most likely to get a hold of people during those times. The key is just to pick up the phone. You just have to be willing to call. Some people are really not that good on the phone. Maybe they're not that confident. It can be taught, but if you really don't like it, it's probably not for you. But it's really actually not that hard. And once you practice, and we provide all the training and the practice, you know, if you're looking to, if you don't want to set up the ads yourself and worry about all that stuff, and you're looking to work online leads, we are looking for agents to join the network who might want to work some of our online leads. And we will train you how to use the scripts, the follow-up, the system, the CRM, and all that. Yep.
So, Mike, here's a great question from Diane. With the online lead, they are likely visiting other sites and talking to other agents, or will be soon. At what point do you get a commitment from them to work exclusively with you?
You know, it's a tough one. From my experience with talking to people on the, like online leads on the phone and how that relationship develops, is you want there to be a low barrier of entry, you know, early on, and you want to try to build that rapport by providing the best customer service possible. That's the approach with our site, is when we call them, it's like, if you've ever gotten a call from someone from Google or whatever, you know, they're just all about the customer service. I'm not here to push sales on you. We're just here to help. You know, is your search set up properly? Are you getting the listings you're looking for? We're here to help. Just let me know. That's it. That's how it starts. And if they continue to follow up with you and you see that they're interacting on the site and you're following up with them over time, that relationship develops. What we found is that I've had many conversations with online leads who say, oh my goodness, you know, I've registered for many sites, but you're the first agent who's actually called me. So I think there's a lot of agents out there who might have some kind of a site that are collecting leads, but they're just not making the calls.
Yeah, I'm sure you're right about that. Any other questions for Mike? Online lead capture. I've got one. Mike, do you find you have to invest in the Google AdWords or getting placed on Google? Is that part of your budget for this? And what do you spend on this platform?
The platform we're on, there, it's a subscription fee, so we're paying for the use of the CRM, just like you would for any CRM. They're based out of the States, and then on top of that, you determine what you want to spend for your ad spend. Right now, we're averaging approximately $3 a buyer lead. Right now, seller leads are a lot more expensive. Leads in Vancouver are actually fairly affordable. There's certain cities in the States that they're very expensive, but $3 on average for a lead, depending if it's coming from Facebook or Google. Some leads are $1.80, some leads are a little bit more than $3, but that's what we're averaging. I'm not going to say exactly what as a team we're spending on our ad spend, but yeah, that's what a typical lead runs.
Okay, well, I'll put out last call for questions. Christy Laniato has one about, can you be specific about regions? I'm not quite sure what you mean by that, Christy. Do you?
Yeah, I got it.
Okay.
Yeah, no, you can, definitely. So we have our system set up to just be generating leads and running ads in North Vancouver, West Vancouver, and Vancouver. But it's not to say that you might get the odd lead coming in from New West or somewhere else, but those are the areas that our team wants to really focus on. So.
Yeah, that's exactly what I meant. Thanks so much. Michelle was saying, you know, some of us, like, I just like to be on the North Shore, and that really helps me. So sorry about the dogs. Thank you very much.
No problem. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like I mentioned, when Andrew and I started the website, our goal was to try to bring all the best of what we had experienced with the past teams we'd worked on with the fairest commission splits with the leads that we're bringing in. So if anyone's interested, feel free to reach out to me. I'd be happy to talk to you guys more about that.
All right. Thank you, Mike. That's a quick overview on website lead gen. And now we're going to talk to Jay. Are you there, Jay?
Yeah, I'm here.
Oh, there he is. All right.
Hi, everybody hear me?
So, Jay, you've been working a lot with YouTube.
Yeah, so I'm on board with Mike's program. The bulk of the business, sort of the bread and butter, I see as the Sync platform. So I'm cold calling like an animal. Yesterday I made like 70 calls. So that I still see that as the bread and butter. what I've been doing a couple of years ago, I started making YouTube videos just talking about the real estate market, really just as a hobby. And then, you know, as I became more interested, I started making these videos before I ever got my license to become a realtor. So, you know, as time went on, I got licensed, and I just started sort of polishing them more, working out some of the sound issues that I had, getting a better microphone. I started doing the videos from the office that Andrew leases, wearing suits and so on, try to give it more of a professional edge, more polished. And so I've just kind of been gradually making the videos better. I've got a guy, Josh Lasko, who I highly recommend, does some really cool footage. And so I've spliced some footage of Vancouver on a sunny day to try and add some more visual kind of pop. And, you know, I'm not, first of all, I'm not PewDiePie or anything. I don't have a trillion followers or anything like that. It's a small channel, but I'm getting between now, depending on how often I post, I'm getting between about 500 and 1500 views every 48 hours, according to the analytics that tell you, you know, they'll tell you what demographic, what age the people are watching your videos. And I'm starting to get some results. So, you know, unlike Sync, which provides me 3 or 4 leads maybe per day, I might only get, you know, a handful of leads per month out of YouTube. However, they tend to be warm leads. So they've been following, watching what I have to say for a year, 2 years. And a lot of the cases, they're pre-qualified. I just had a guy contact me, went for coffee with him. He wants to build a real estate portfolio in Vancouver. He's pulling in $500,000 a year. I got another guy, we're talking about doing a land assembly. I hooked him up with Eugene Klein to develop this 140-unit complex in Granville Island. So if I hadn't have done that, you know, started this YouTube thing, those connections wouldn't have been made. So it's really, really valuable. I'm very introverted, so it's pushing my comfort zone a little bit. But I think a lot of people, you know, if you're scared to get out there and do it, you know, that's natural. But I would say, you know, take a crack at it. It takes some time to build up a viewer base. But I think social media is pretty effective. I mean, I've seen realtors put out newsletters and stuff. But I think now with the video content, it just takes it up another level. And I'm starting to now, rather than put out a monthly email, I'll send out a monthly or a bi-monthly video to all of my Sync leads as well. So I'm now kind of synergizing the two platforms. So yeah, I'd encourage people to give it a shot. And like I say, I don't get a lot of lead gen. I still see Sync as sort of my bread and butter, but I'm sort of building this side hustle at the same time. So
this is kind of more of a form of passive advertising where you're putting content out there for people to enjoy. You were saying they might follow you for a year or two before they reach out. When they do reach out, what's the ask that really pulls them in? Do they tend to be contacting you over a specific property you're talking about? Is it just that they feel that they've built an affinity towards you because they've been watching your content? Tell us about the conversion, and what do those clients who pick up the phone and talk to you or reach out to you, however they do, what is their rationale that they tell you for having done so?
Usually they relate to something that I've said, or they like kind of my position on various topics. And yeah, usually when they reach out, they're pretty much ready to go. You know, they're pre-qualified, or they're going to talk to my broker to get pre-qualified. And yeah, they're pretty warm leads for the most part. I mean, unlike Sync, where, you know, they might have gone on the website and looked at a couple of properties, but they don't know who you are. They've never heard of you before. This way, like you say, it's a lot more passive. You don't have to reach out to the client so much. They're reaching out to you. And so you're operating kind of from a position of authority. So it's really, really effective. And I could see maybe 4 or 5 years from now where I just do a couple of videos a month or a weekly video, and I don't have to use the Sync platform anymore because now I have people calling me as opposed to having to reach out to them. So long term, I think it's pretty powerful.
Jay, is this part of a broader social media strategy where you're incorporating a Facebook group, Instagram, other things as well, or is this more standalone, or how does it fold into the rest of your marketing?
Well, that's what I'm trying to figure out. You know, I'm thinking about doing a newsletter. The meeting with Eugene Klein, he did a PowerPoint presentation. Excuse me one second.
Okay. any questions in the meantime? We can hit Jay when he comes back.
Hi, sorry. I'm here.
Mike had a question about, specifically he was asking, do you cover controversial content? I think we could actually extrapolate that out to a broader question and just ask what type of content do you cover? Is there a mix of content that's more sort of topical, or is it listing specific, or what does a video look like?
So yeah, I mean, if you go on YouTube and just type in my name, Jay Kupar, C-O-U-P-A-R, you'll see. Yeah, so every video I do is kind of different. I try not to do the standard, you know, sales are up, sales are down, this is your sales to active listings ratio, and, you know, that kind of thing. I do a little bit of that, but, you know, it's sometimes I think people find it a little bit dry. So I try to cover on a variety of different topics. I'm also going more towards an interview format. So I'm interviewing economists. I interviewed Brendan Augmentson. I interviewed former Mayor Sam Sullivan on the affordability issues. Andre Pavlov, who's a professor of finance at Simon Fraser, I interviewed him. So I'm talking a lot about sort of the economic side of it, prices, affordability, you know, how the political aspect sort of affects the market. I try to kind of cover everything. Sort of the wealth divide, how, you know, we have sort of a situation in Vancouver where we've got a lot of people that own a lot of property and that have profited a great deal, and then a lot of people that are on the sidelines. So I try to cover everything.
Another question from Mike. How often do you have people reaching out to you through the YouTube platform?
Yeah, I mean, I've started spending a little bit of ad spend on Google ads lately. So I budgeted about $15 a day. Last month I've had about 3 meetings as a result of it. So it depends. I'm going to say 3 to 5 meetings per month that gets me.
How often do you put a video out, Jay?
Once or twice a week. I try to.
So about 8 videos a month, kind of as the mood strikes you or you have a certain thing to say.
Yeah, just whenever I feel like doing it, I do it. There's no real rhyme or schedule to it. Yeah.
Okay.
But again, I just see it as something to kind of complement whatever it is you're doing. Like I say, Sync is the bread and butter. Making those calls is the main thing, just staying consistent with the phone calls. But it is nice to have some alternate. I think you got to attack it from every direction that you can, right?
Yeah, well, I would agree with you completely. Any questions for Jay on YouTube in particular, perhaps social media in general, if you're...
Another thing I wanted to mention too, in my meeting with Eugene Klein, he did a PowerPoint presentation that was fantastic. And that's another avenue I'm looking at. So when I do say a client watches a video, they want to get together over a cup of coffee and discuss options, financing, building a portfolio, whatever. I want to be able to bring out and show them a PowerPoint presentation very similar to Eugene's, because his was really, really compelling. So that's another avenue I want to look at.
Okay. Well, I think that will probably pretty well conclude Jay's thoughts on YouTube. Last call for questions, but otherwise I think we're going to move on pretty quickly. But thank you for that, Jay. That's quite insightful. You see,
no comment on Mike's, I see he's being cheeky there.
Yeah. I just assumed that you do your own. So, so no further questions. Thank you, Jay.
Sure.
Good luck and continued success on YouTube. And now I will move on to Colleen. Are you on the call, Colleen? Sure.
Yes, I am. Hopefully everyone can hear me and see me okay.
We can see you and hear you just fine, Colleen. And you're going to talk to us that something after YouTube and website lead gen is going to sound a lot more old-fashioned and quaint. Mm-hmm. And you're going to talk to us a little bit about print media.
Yes, I am. So most people don't know me. I've been licensed for 15 years. I've worked half my career in the Fraser Valley and half here. And I think, like you said in the beginning, Lawrence, do something you like, you're comfortable with, do something fun. I think I've heard that from the other speakers as well. Some of my marketing and advertising. So that's why I picked up on the print media. So I'm just going to jump right in. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what the print media is that I have and why I use it and a little bit about the costs. So one of the people or groups I like to advertise to and market to would be my A-list. So my A-list clients, the people who would refer to me you know, maybe people I want to do business with. So I'm just going to show you, this is a magazine. I don't know if you guys can see that okay. So it's called Home by Designs. It's 50 pages. So it's all color. It's all printed for me. This is something that I'll send out to them. It goes out every 2 months. And if you can see, there's a little picture of me on the front. there's no advertising in my magazine unless I put it in there. So everything's written for me. On the back, I'll advertise my listings and maybe a call to action. In the front cover, I'll advertise, you know, maybe something about my business or a message for my readers. And then the back inside page, I don't know if you guys can see that okay. These are advertisers. So these are local businesses that I know, people that I want to work with. And I get their permission, of course, to advertise them in my magazine. I think for me, what it does is it establishes some goodwill in the community. Plus, it gets me out meeting other businesses, local businesses. A lot of them will be businesses that a real estate agent might use, like a cleaner, an inspector, mortgage broker. I'll just show you a couple of other just the friends. So they're quite attractive. And that goes out again, I think I said every 2 months, the people that get them, they love to receive them. It also gives me an opportunity to, phone these people and talk to them. Hey, did you get my magazine? What did you think? I'm looking for some feedback. And then that can establish more of a conversation and maybe lead into real estate. Again, these are people that I know, I've known for a long time. You know, they're my A-list people. Most of my business for quite a long time has been just working from the people I know, my sphere of influence, getting referrals from them, getting their new business, whether they're selling and rebuying something or buying an investment property. So that's why I use the magazine, because I find it's a really good tool. With that, I also get, and they're mailed. So the company prints the magazine and mails them right out to my list. but they also mail me extra copies, and those copies I can hand out at open houses. I know we're not doing a lot of them anymore. I also do networking, so I can hand them out to people I meet at networking groups. I can give them to my neighbor, pretty much anybody I meet. And it's quite a nice piece to be able to present to somebody. Also with the magazine, I do get a weekly article that I can put on social media. So I've put that on my Facebook, as well as LinkedIn. So a little bit about the cost. So again, how many copies you buy, the more you buy, the less it costs. So I'm running anywhere from about $3.80 to about $4.15 per issue. It's not that much money. It's, you know, a cup of coffee nowadays. And again, I'm only using them to my A-list clients or potential clients. So yeah, I'll just, unless anybody has any questions. Oh, who makes the magazine? The magazines, it's called Home by Design. So they're a company, they put out they have two types of magazines. One's a 50 page, that's the one I use, and that goes out every 2 months. They also do a smaller magazine, about 10 or 12 pages, and that goes out every month. So I just like the larger magazine. Any other questions for magazines? I'll just move on to some of the other print media. So I'll kind of show you. I have a whole stack of stuff here that I do. So I got branded quite a long time ago. When I initially started in real estate, I tried all kinds of things. I've been to conferences. I've tried a little lead gen. But I always went back to print media because that's what makes me happy. So everything that I have looks the same. This is a brochure that I've created. This is a flyer. And again, on the back of the flyer are more of my advertisers. Some people will charge their advertisers money to be a part, to cross-advertise is what it's called. And that can help offset the costs of printing. Little notepad. This is an old one. That's an old picture. But what I want to talk to you is about the postcard. And I don't know if you can see this very well on the back. So I print, again, local businesses on the back here. And I usually try to print either something that has to do with real estate or that is a little more my character. So I like yoga, I like bike riding, and this is a yoga studio. I don't know if you can see. And I always try to get somebody who prints on the back to do a coupon or some kind of an offer. The reason I do that is the pieces tend to stay around a little bit longer. So I'll give you a bit of a story. When I started a long time ago, I cross-advertised with Tracy Cakes Bakery Cafe. And what we did is we did 2-for-1 cupcakes. So everybody wants a free cupcake. So a lot of the coupons were redeemed. And I became sort of known as the cupcake realtor. We did a lot of other advertising with Tracy Cakes as well, but it's something that, you know, people, they grab this, maybe they stick it on the fridge, they stick it in the purse, and then they use it. So they're seeing it maybe a couple of times, and then they look forward to getting something from me in the mail. Why do I do print advertising? I like to farm a neighborhood. It does take a long time. You can't just send out, one set of postcards or notepads and expect you're going to get calls. You need a number of touches. You really should do something once a month. But I farm because I want people to recognize my face, my name, and what I do within a particular neighborhood so that over time, you know, they might see me around town, they keep getting things from me. They might have some questions. They might decide to reach out. And that has happened in the past. I'll give you a story about when I was in a grocery store and the people ahead of me, I had their grocery list on my notepad and they turned around and they said, "Hey, this is you." So struck up a conversation and, you know, things go from there. So for cost, again, how many you purchase, the more you purchase, the less it will cost you. I purchased 15 of the postcards. So I purchased the shells. So a postcard shell is just the color part. And then it sits down at the printer. And when you have something to print on the back, they'll imprint it and mail it out for you. So for everything, the shell, the imprint and mailing, it's about 25 cents per piece. The flyers here, double-sided color, that's about 27 cents a piece. The notepads are a little bit more. My last quote for about 2,500 notepads would have been about 53 cents a piece. Plus mailing puts you at about 65 cents. But I used to order 10,000 notepads at a time. So you'll bring your cost down quite a bit. Yeah, I don't know. Does anybody have any questions?
Any questions for Colleen on any aspect of her print campaign? A lot of people want to know who does your printing for you. That's that for Mike and Karen Erickson.
Okay. So I get the postcards printed at Contact Printer. They're here in North Vancouver. They're down in Lower Lawns.
The funny sign when you
yes. drive
sports.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. So they do my printing of my postcards. I've been doing my just my flyers, like the regular kind of two-sided flyers. I use a print broker here. She's really great, and she'll shop around everywhere. She, you know, in the U.S. or Canada to get the lowest rate for you. So I thought that she did a pretty good job on the print. The one thing though that I can't quote you on is graphics. So I do all my own graphic work. Because I do have a background in graphics. So if you're not doing your own graphic work, then there'll be an additional cost for that.
Okay.
Oh.
I was just going to add one thought to you touched on the importance of doing things frequently, at least once mm-hmm. a month, in your words, not expecting to do one mail out of notepads and get 10 phone calls. But showing up consistently so that people, you know, begin to recognize your brand, recognize you, and eventually when they need to, feel comfortable reaching out to you. I would suggest no matter what method of prospecting you do, that's pretty much the same. You can't go do door knocking for one afternoon and expect a bunch of calls. Nor can you do online lead generation for a month or make one YouTube video or anything you do, whatever method you do, consistency is going to be absolutely key. Colleen, a question for Mike. How often do you get a call or more generally, what is your response rate in general?
So I've only just started marketing here on the North Shore. So most of my marketing was done back in the Fraser Valley, when I did do regular monthly mail outs. I also did other things too. So I advertised in the newspaper, I had a bus bench, I was going to networking events. So I was really getting out in the community. So I was getting a lot of calls and a lot of work from that. As far as the North Shore, I've been mainly operating through my past clients' referrals, friends and family, and I've been working that a bit harder over the last few years. So I'm just starting to branch out again and do the farming.
Yeah. Any other questions on print advertising? Any questions in general at this point from anybody? It's a quiet group. We've got more than 30 people on this call. Well, final thoughts, Colleen, on print advertising?
Final thoughts. I think it's go back to do what you're comfortable with, what you like. Mix it up, try as many different things.
I would agree with that. I think particularly when you're new, trying different things so you can figure out what method is working for you is really, really important. Consistency is key. So we're starting to hear a lot of the same themes. I find that interesting. We've talked about building a referral network. We've talked about website lead generation. We've talked about YouTube and social media. We've talked about print advertising. But you've all basically said the same thing. You have to do it frequently. You have to be consistent in your message. You can't just, it's not a one and done thing. It's part of an ongoing campaign that really never stops. Further to that, I know Al Sutton in this office always talked about when he got started, he would do something he called 20 and 20. He wouldn't leave the office until he made 20 phone calls, and he wouldn't go home after leaving the office until he had knocked on 20 doors. And, that's a very manageable amount for just about anybody to do. I think what happened, I know I used to, feel guilty from time to time at a lack of prospecting and think, okay, well, next Friday, I really got to knuckle down. I'm going to go out there and knock on 100 doors. And, you set these tasks for yourself that are so, so large and so daunting that it becomes very easy to talk yourself out of doing them all together. But if you can make 20 phone calls and knock on 20 doors, just about anybody can do that. And when you add that up, that's 100 phone calls a week and 100 doors a week. That's over 5,000 a year. If you want to make Medallion Club, you need, generally about 24 deals or so to make it. How many deals do you need? I think if you make 5,000 calls and knock on 5,000 doors, you will probably find that you do quite well. And I think the same would be true of generating 5,000 online leads or doing mailers. So consistency is definitely a key with all of these. We had talked a bit, particularly when we were talking about referrals, about past clients and lead generation. That's something else. I mean, your past clients, the client that you have already acquired, however you got them originally, really should now be yours, barring some sort of falling out, or perhaps a client gets a family member comes into the business or something like that. They decide they want to start working with them or something like that. They should have no one else to call but you. You worked with them before. If you stay in touch and maintain that relationship, that should be the easiest client that you'll ever get, is the client that you already have. One thing I would do, and I'll show my example to everybody, and I think it's a great thing to do. If nothing else, it'll make you feel really good from time to time if you're having a bad day. I'd keep a binder, and this is a binder I got from the board on some course I did whenever, so I just put it in there because it was nicely branded that way. But in this, I printed out the full realtor sheet of all the deals I did over about 15 years. So I've got quite a few in here, and I'd use this for a few things. I'd use it for buyer and seller listing presentations to show them that I had in fact had a record of business, and that they could see from these sheets how well my negotiating track record was as well. If as a buyer, how far the sale price was under ask, or in the event of a listing, how close it was to ask or over ask. But the other thing that comes in really handy from time to time is every once in a while I would just sit down here and flip through this and realize, oh yeah, I haven't talked to that guy. That's a client, Raymond. I haven't talked to him in a long time. I should maybe give him a call. Yeah, they bought this place March 07. Maybe it's time to sell. So going back over your own clients and keeping track of those, whether you use a CRM or something kind of old school like this, that's the best way to go. And not only is it the clients themselves, but when you reach out to them, is just asking them, hey, do you know anybody in the market? Do you have a neighbor that's looking to sell? Do you know anybody that's interested in buying? And further to that, I would say one of the things that I think every salesperson should be able to get comfortable with as a sales tactic is get comfortable with uncomfortable silence. It's not enough to just say, hey, do you know anyone looking to buy or sell? You know, it's okay if you don't, but you know, if you do, I hope you keep me in mind. I think the way to really capitalize is you talk to a client and say, hey, Colleen, I'm looking at Colleen now on the screen. So if Colleen were my client, I would say, Colleen, do you know anybody looking to buy or sell? Long, uncomfortable silence. You know, just because I really, you know, I really want Colleen to think about whether or not she does know anybody in the market. And maybe she won't think about it right now, but maybe she'll call me later with something. In either event, I want that to hang there. I want Colleen to know that I'm looking for her help. Fundamentally, I think just about anybody is quite happy to help you out, particularly if they like you and have worked with you. If you think in your own life, if a friend or neighbor called you and asked for your help, I think not only do most people want to, I think you almost feel kind of flattered that you'd be asked for help. So just making those calls, reaching out to people and asking them, do you know anybody? I think that's vitally important. That's a little less passive, a little more aggressive. Door knocking. We had a few people mention door knocking earlier on. Who here is doing some door knocking? You can use the raise hand feature. You can say me in the chat box. You can unmute yourself and tell me if you're doing it. I know we've got people here doing door knocking. Nightmare, says Karen Erickson. Shaddy's still doing it. I don't want to put Shaddy on the spot, but Shaddy, do you want to tell us a little bit about your door knocking? Maybe not.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, tell us about it. How do you pick an area? And when you go to the door, what do you say?
So actually, I'm new with Royal Page. I used to be with Century 21 for a year and a half, and I just joined like 2 months. And I'm working also with Amir Hamzali in the Royal Page Sussex in West Vancouver. So like as a part of the team, so we have to do a door knocking. It's a really routine that, you know, like 3 days, 4 days in a week. So we have to, it's, so Amir is categorized like some area that we have to do for door knocking. We just did some part of, in Vancouver, Westside, Kitsilano, Point Grey, last 2 weeks ago, and still doing some part of in West Vancouver, Bay Bridge, and, you know, some other area in Horseshoe Bay. So, yeah. So basically, we have some brochure, you know, which is, you know, like a prepared from Amir's office. So we are handing, because if we are a part of the team and we have a split with the Amir team, so we are like going and introducing ourselves, and sometimes we are like random door knocking. We are offering like free home evaluation. So we have like a paper ready on top of the brochure, you know, with our card on. So some people, you know, they answer and, you know, we start to talk, but, you know, some of them just we leave the brochure there. Yeah.
Okay. And how many people do you find home, and how many people want to talk?
It's a little bit weird. Mostly, like I don't know. I figure out like mostly like in West Vancouver, the people they most respond, like, because with, I mean, the time that we go, it's between like 11 till like 4, so we have to, I think it's better to go back after 5, the people that are coming back from work, but you know, it's my time, it's my schedule, I can't go after. But yeah, the people, you know, if they're home, they answer the door, start to talk. Some people said no, we have our own agent. Like some, you know, said, yeah, you can leave the brochure maybe in case if you decide. Yeah.
So because you're still doing this currently, Brandon had a good question here. He says he used to do it regularly, but worries that it's not socially acceptable these days with COVID and social distancing, and wonders, you know, how do people react to that? Do you wear a mask when you go door to door?
We don't, I, you know, first I was wearing masks, but I said it's not a good way because, you know, if you're wearing mask, why you're going and, you know, knocking and start to talk to someone. So we have our mask, but it's, you know, when they open the door, we just go a little bit like further and start to talk. So we are not that much close to, you
know. So you just take a step back after knocking.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And people have found that fairly acceptable.
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't see anything like regarding the COVID, you know, they don't want to like, you know, it's just for the COVID. They don't want to like, I mean, they just respond and they talk. Yeah. Because, you know, it's fairly, it's a good distance. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I take my hat off to anybody who can door knock. It's a great way to get exercise and a sure way to get plenty of rejection. But, you know, if you do enough of it, it does turn into business. A little side note, I'll tell a quick story that I've maybe told a few times, so I need to come up with some new material, but maybe there'll be a few people hearing it for the first time. It's an old story. It's from about 30 years ago, but it's about Tony Rossetti, and he's been in business for about 50 years. I think we all know who Tony Rossetti is, a North fan. And if you know Jordan Rossetti, I went to school with Jordan Rossetti, and he and I were on the same baseball team. There's a reason I don't play baseball professionally. I'm in real estate. I was a terrible baseball player. But we were playing one day out in the diamond off Delbrook there. And my dad and Tony were sitting next to each other in the stands. And they were chatting. And all of a sudden in the mid-conversation, Tony said, Larry, let me stop you there. Jordan's not at bat in this inning. So there are three houses across the street there on Delbrook. I'm just going to go knock those doors and I'll be back for the next inning. He went off to do that. So when you get back to the common theme we were talking about consistency, you know, and doing those 20 a day, whatever your method is, and Tony used to do a lot of door knocking, it works. It's as simple as that. So it's not for everybody, but for those who can make it work, like any method, it's all about consistency and getting out there and talking to people. Some people are quite passive about it. You know, when Al Sutton was telling me about his 20 and 20 plan, he would never ask, are you thinking of buying or selling? He'd just say, how are you doing? Are you looking for any information in the area? Are you curious about what some of the neighboring homes have sold for? He was quite passive. Other people like Don Eilers, who's built a lot of business, if you know Don, a longtime Remax agent in West Van, most of his business he gets out of door knocking. And he goes, I think it's 2 or 3 times a week he goes. He goes off in the morning. He brings a water bottle with him. And he picks an area and goes up and down. And he just asks people, are you interested in selling your house? If they say no, it's okay. He turns around and goes to the next house. He is, he's brutal. He's very, very direct. But again, kind of speaks to his personality and the way he wants to do business. So again, finding that comfort level of something you can do and do consistently. You know, I think that's what it's all about. Before we kind of close off here, are there any questions in general about any method or perhaps a method of prospecting we haven't talked about? Questions on anything we have talked about? type into the chat box or unmute yourself. Otherwise, we'll kind of start to close this off. I suppose in general, I would just say that, you know, we're in a challenging time when it comes to prospecting for business. As people have alluded to, open houses, not so easy. Other social circle events, whether you go to a church or a Rotary Club or anything that might bring business about through social interaction, that's obviously a lot harder to do these days. And as Brandon had alluded to, even door knocking, maybe not everybody's comfortable with it. It's challenging and you have to be creative. But whatever you do, you also have to be consistent. I go back to that statistic that prospecting is what realtors do 64% of the time. So if that statistic is true, that would really suggest that in an 8-hour workday, you should be spending 4 or 5 hours a day on prospecting. Now that might be an awful lot for some people, but I think whatever you do, whether it's the 20 and 20 idea that Al Sutton had, or two hours a day or whatever works for you that you can fold in and stick with, that's what you gotta do. You gotta stick to it and block that time off as if no differently than it were a listing presentation or a PDP course or something else that would be scheduled. Don't be your own worst enemy and talk yourself out of prospecting. It's vital to your business and you have to do it and do it consistently. And you have to reward yourself for a job well done when you do it. If you've made those 2 hours of calls every day, or you've made all those posts or done those door knocks that you'd planned to do, buy yourself a lunch at the end of the week or take yourself out. You know, make it fun, do something that you enjoy, that you can be proud of, and go make the most of it. Those are my final thoughts. Anybody else with anything to say before we sign off? I think that's it. I wish you all the best of luck out prospecting for business, and wish you all a terrific fall.
Lawrence, one sec, email me V numbers.
Yes, V numbers for Sari to get your credit for today. Please email Sari. Okay. Thank you, everybody.